Hi, this is Tom Johnson. I'm a partner in Philadelphia in the Labor and Employment Group at Dechert. And you're about to join us for our webinar. It's here, what you need to know about the DOL's new rule for FLSA white-collar exemptions. With me today is Ian Downs and Jeff Rubin, also both of the Philadelphia office here and both members of our Labor and Employment Group. As we go through the webinar, you'll see on the right-hand side of your screen questions that will pop up from time to time, and we encourage you to participate in answering those multiple choice questions. At the end of our presentation, we'll review the results with all of you to see how you're responding to this important new development in the law. But first, we want to go through what exactly has happened.
Hello, everyone. This is Jeffrey Rubin. And as Tom mentioned, we're going to go through the white-collar exemptions and the new rule changes. So first of all, what do we mean by the white-collar exemptions? Well, at its most basic level, the Fair Labor Standards Act imposes two requirements on employers. First, they have to pay all of their employees at least the federal minimum wage, which is currently $7.25 per hour. And second, they have to pay the employee at least 1.5 times their regular hourly rate for hours worked more than 40 in a work week. But the statute has a series of exceptions to them, which exempts people from either the minimum wage and or, in some cases, both, the overtime regulations. And here, the white-collar exemptions are the most common exemptions, and that does exempt workers from both the minimum wage and overtime requirements. They're called the white-collar exemptions because they apply to executive, administrative, and professional workers. They're also sometimes referred to as the EAP exemptions because of those categories. So what do you need to satisfy in order to be an exempt employee under these white-collar exemptions? Three different things. First, you have to pay the employee on a salary basis. That means that the employee has to receive a predetermined and fixed salary that doesn't vary based on the quality or quantity of work performed. So unlike an hourly worker who you can tell don't come into work for a few days or a half a day or a few hours because there's not work and therefore you don't have to pay them, you can't do that for someone you are paying on a salary basis. Second, you have to make sure that they are being paid on a salary basis at least the minimum salary level. And finally, the employee has to be engaged in certain types of duties, namely executive, administrative, or professional duties. One of the most common misconceptions under the Fair Labor Standards Act is many times clients and employers say, well, if I'm paying someone on a salary basis and I'm paying them a sufficiently high salary, that means they're exempt, right? That is not true, especially under the white-collar exemptions, because you also need to meet this duties test, which we'll talk about in a little bit more detail later. But these new rules that we're going to focus on today focus upon the salary level test, and that is where the change is being made.
How did we get where we are today? Well, the simple explanation is that President Obama in 2014 directed the DOL to update the regulation. It hadn't been updated since 2004, and the directive was really to modernize and simplify. Whether or not they actually simplified things, I think, is open to debate, but they certainly have updated it. Last year, many of you remember our surprise in the summer that the proposed revised regulations were released. There was a comment period that closed in September, and as you can expect with such an important issue, many, many comments were received, approximately 300,000. I think it might have been a little bit less than that, but it's in that neighborhood. And they came from employee groups, employer groups, law professors, individuals, you name it, they felt like they were going to comment and did. On May 18th, just about 2 weeks ago, the final rule was, in fact, released, and that's what we're talking about today. And, again, one of these dates you can't learn well enough. December the 1st, 2016 is the effective date and when you have to comply with this entire new rule. The root of the update is based, frankly, in the DOL's belief that the 2004 update, the last one, was not exactly what was intended and, in fact, had the effect of diminishing the rights of the middle class, if you believe the DOL, in terms of how they're phrasing this. The 2004 update, many of you remember, there the salary level was increased from $155 a week to $455 a week to the current threshold of $23,660. That seems like an awfully large increase, but you have to keep in mind that the last prior update before 2004 was in 1975. So they had gone decades without an update before then. The other things that they did in 2004 was that they modified the duties test, one of those standard three-part tests that Jeff talked about a minute or so ago, and they eliminated the long and short duties tests. There were two tests. The long duty test applied to those who earned on the lower end of the scale. The short duties test applied to those who earned on the higher end of the scale. They replaced both of those with a standard test and paired that standard test with effectively the short duties test. And that's the test we have in place today. They also created a highly compensated employee exemption. There, the exemption was created for those who earn more than $100,000 in total annual compensation. And that was paired with a variant of the standard test, which is described as a minimal duties test. For those of you who are in industries with lots of folks who earn more than $100,000, I'm sure that you're familiar with this particular exemption. It is more forgiving than the standard test. Where did we finally settle? Well, the most important thing for you to probably take away from this presentation is this. Although the DOL initially last year proposed the threshold level of $50,440 per year or $970 per week, they actually reduced that amount. So the actual threshold that you must now keep in mind when determining whether or not someone is overtime eligible or overtime exempt, to use the new phrasing, is $47,476 per year or $913 per week. Where did that come from? Well, it comes from data that's based in the fourth quarter of 2015, so it's fairly recent, and that $47,476 per year is the mark for the 40th percentile of weekly earnings of full-time salaried employees. Now, there's a lot embedded in there, and in particular, they're looking at the lowest wage census region to gather that data, in this case, the South. This was done in response to concerns by folks who are located in more rural, less metropolitan areas, where the wage scale is lower. In response to that, as opposed to creating individual standards for specific regions or states, they instead relied upon one standard based upon the lowest wage census region, again, in this case, the South.
Good afternoon, everyone. This is Ian Downs jumping in here. So what are the predicted effects of this change? That really is literally the million or $100 million question for employers across the country. The Department of Labor anticipates that for fiscal year 2017, 4.2 million employees who are currently exempt under the salary level test will be considered non-exempt. These are employees who currently make more than the $455 a week, but will no longer satisfy the $913 requirement. Additionally, 5.7 million employees who are currently non-exempt, but who do meet the salary test, will have their statuses, quote-unquote, strengthened because they will now no longer meet the salary level test. Additionally, it's anticipated that 65,000 highly compensated employees will lose the exemption. So in terms of the implementation of this new salary level test, one of the critical questions that was answered by the Department of Labor is whether or not bonuses will be counted as part of determining the compensation considered in determining whether the salary level is met. Under the 2004 regulations, Bonuses, incentive payments, and commissions were not included, could not be counted by employers in determining whether the salary level threshold had been hit. That has now changed. The Department of Labor, in response to comments, has agreed to allow up to 10% of an employee's salary threshold to be met through the use of non-discretionary bonuses, incentive payments, and commissions. This is the most one of the most critical aspects of this is that the bonuses must be non-discretionary. As is often the case in bonus plans, employers attempt to retain some degree of discretion with respect to the bonuses. If that is a component of plans, that can create a problem and may well result in the exclusion of these bonus payments. One of the questions was, well, what happens with employees who may not, who may reach the salary threshold with bonuses in one quarter, but not in another? Is there anything an employer can do? And backing up just for a second, with respect to the bonuses must be paid no less than quarterly. The Department of Labor had originally suggested that bonuses would need to be paid on a monthly basis. They responded to a bevy of comments suggesting that that just isn't in line with how employers make bonus payments, and they did adjust the final regulations so that quarterly bonus payments are sufficient. With respect to those employees who may be close to hitting the threshold, employers are not permitted to make catch-up payments at the end of the year. You cannot look back at an employee and pay them a one-time annual bonus to bring them up to the $47,476 threshold. You can, however, make quarterly payments, payments at the end of the quarter within one pay period in order to bring the employee within up to the level during that quarter. The Department of Labor recognized that this is a new aspect of these regulations and may the implementation of it may involve some uncertainty and has suggested that they will be issuing further guidance on that. So that is something to keep an eye on. As Tom mentioned, the highly compensated employee regulations have changed. The threshold here has been modified. Generally, to qualify for the highly compensated employee exemption, one needed to be paid over $100,000 and also meet that minimal duties test, which requires that an employee customarily and regularly engage in administrative, executive, or professional duties. The level that was proposed in the regulation announced last year was tied to the 90th percentile of the annualized earnings of full-time salaried employees nationally. It was anticipated at the time that would be about $122,000. Based on the fourth quarter data, which from 2015, that number has now increased to $134,004 per year. Interestingly, in announcing this exemption, one of the things that the department was trying to do was target some individuals who were being classified as exempt under the highly compensated employee exemption who they didn't think really fit within that. One of the things that they noted was secretaries in high-wage areas who were, quote, clearly not performing EAP duties. They sought to, although not reforming the duties test, to kind of knock some of those folks out with these new by raising the highly compensated employee exemption. One thing to keep in mind is that the highly compensated employee exemption is calculated based on total annual compensation for employees. However, the lower regular salary threshold still needs to be met without the inclusion of bonuses. So employees who are being treated as exempt under the highly compensated employee exemption may still need to satisfy the regular salary level test based on their regular earnings.
I think for many people, the most controversial part of the new rule is, in fact, the automatic indexing, which we're seeing. Included within the new rule is a provision that updates the threshold amount from time to time. Originally, it was anticipated that this would be done once every year. Now, with the final rule, it will update once every 3 years on January the 1st, as you can see there. The goal here was to avoid the long interim periods which we've experienced in the past between updating. So think about, for instance, the period between 1975 and 2004 when there was no update, and again, more recently, between 2004 and 2016. People felt that the exemptions had sort of lost their purpose and been diluted into something they weren't intended to be by this long period in between. How will it be updated? Well, again, it's going to be keyed to the 40th percentile of weekly earnings of full-time salaried workers in the lowest wage census region. For now, that looks like it's going to be the South, but that certainly could vary, and we won't know until we get to January the 1st of 2020 when the next update is going to be announced, when the threshold amount will be updated. Currently, the DOL is anticipating that the amount in January of 2020 will rise to $51,168, and the highly compensated employee exemption will rise to $147,524. Whether or not those will be the exact numbers or not, nobody knows. They're just basing it on prior wage growth in the South at this point. One thing that people are concerned about with this particular method is what they describe as the ratcheting problem. Because the 40th percentile is set based looking at full-time salaried workers, what people expect to happen as part of the new rule is that there will be salaried workers who are converted into hourly ones, typically people who earn on the lower end of the scale. So what you will be left with in the pool of salaried full-time workers are higher earners, and the 40th percentile will be set at a higher number. So it's possible that this will jump to a higher number than is currently anticipated. People didn't like this, but the DOL didn't particularly care. The DOL also rejected proposals to link it to the consumer price index and inflation and other potential proposals that were put forward. They said that this was the fairest and easiest way to do it. How will you know about the new threshold? Well, you'll get plenty of notice. The amount will be published in the Federal Register at least 150 days before the effective date. I am sure it will be covered widely in the press, and it will also be available on the DOL's website and in other places. The real question is whether or not automatic indexing will survive a challenge. Of all the parts of the new rule, this is the part of the rule that is most likely to face a judicial challenge. Why? Well, for starters, in 2004, the Wage and Hour Division had determined that it did not have the authority to create an automatic indexing system. Commentators, folks who submitted comments during the period related to the proposed rule, believe that this violates the Administrative Procedures Act, the Regulatory Flexibility Act, and Executive Order 13563. Whether it does or not is uncertain, but I have a feeling that we're going to see a legal challenge to this very soon. What about the duties test? This is probably the question that we get the most from people. And if you recall from the draft, the DOL didn't make any changes or propose changes to the duties test, but they wanted to see how people felt about it. Well, people told them loud and clear. They had, quote, strong and divergent views, which is a nice way of saying nobody agrees and everybody's passionate about it. The big issue here was whether or not they should return to the old system pre-2004 that limited the amount of time that an exempt employee could spend on non-exempt activities. Various commentators proposed limits of 20%, some proposed 50%, which you'll hear later on is really part of the California rule. The DOL said that there was another way to address this, and they were doing it through what they believed was the bright line rule of the salary basis, and that should really provide the guide, and that they weren't going to worry about the duties test at the moment. In response to concerns that were expressed about potential misclassification of folks, and the fact that many of them were using are taking extraordinary amounts of time to spend on non-exempt duties. What the DOL said was eventually that's going to catch up with folks. If you're spending a disproportionate amount of time on non-exempt duties, it means that you are still liable to challenge under the duties test as it exists, and you still must satisfy it. And for those folks, they are at a higher risk. You're not out of the woods, though, because the duties test is evolving quickly through case law, and we want to make sure that people are actually aware of some of these developments and the inconsistencies that are out there. Just because the DOL didn't address it this time doesn't mean you don't have to worry about it.
Yeah, and the duties test is actually one of the most difficult things to try to apply. It's what spawns the most litigation over the white-collar exemptions. And what the duties test focuses on is what is the employee's primary duty? And as Tom suggested just a few moments ago, the DOL was very hesitant and kind of balked at the idea of returning to some sort of set amount of time to determine what an employee's primary duty is. Some states take a different view, as we'll learn in a little while, but it's important for employers to not forget about the duties test because it can be very difficult to apply, as I wanted to highlight in just two cases. The first one is a case against GEICO. Everyone knows GEICO Insurance Company. They have that talking gecko as their mascot with all the commercials. I think they also had some other mascots. They've had a pretty effective marketing campaign, but everyone knows the gecko most recently. And this is a case from the Fourth Circuit decided just a few months ago in December 2015. And the case involved security investigators. Now, apparently, any of you in insurance who are familiar with insurance knows that there's a whole department essentially devoted to rooting out fraud. Apparently, something like 10% of insurance claims are supposedly fraudulent. And so these investigators' jobs are to go and root out fraud. If there's a concern that fraud is taking place, these people go out and investigate. And the primary duty was the investigation of suspected fraud, including reporting their findings as to whether or not fraud was taking place. Now, again, under the duties test, this case was brought under the administrative exemption. Of the three white-collar exemptions, the administrative is the one that's most amorphous. I mean, if you were to walk up to people on the street and ask them, what does an executive do, what does a professional do, most people at least have a sense. The administrative exemption is kind of the catch-all, and so it's a little bit more amorphous than the others. But the two prongs under the duties test for the administrative exemption is that the employee first has to have their primary duty be directly related to the management and general business operations of the employer, and second, the primary duty has to involve the exercise of discretion and independent judgment with respect to matters of significance. Here, when the trial court applied that test, they granted summary judgment in favor of the employees because it says, although the primary duty may have met the second prong or the first prong of the duties test, they did not exercise sufficient discretion and therefore they were not administratively exempt. It goes up to the Fourth Circuit, and the Fourth Circuit disagrees. The Fourth Circuit says that they couldn't even establish that first element. They start off by saying that the exemptions are construed narrowly. They're construed narrowly against the employer, and it's the employer that has the burden of proof of establishing that one of the exemptions applies. And again, it's not just by a preponderance of the evidence. In the Fourth Circuit, the employer has to prove these elements by clear and convincing evidence. And here, the court said GEICO couldn't do it. It's the nature of the work, not how critical that work is to the enterprise that's important. They reference kind of a test that developed out of the old case law, this administrative production dichotomy. They used to be very useful in determining whether or not this prong was satisfied because at the time when a large percentage of the workforce involved plants, it was very easy to tell who was an administrative employee and who was a production employee, whether somebody was working on the production line or not. But the Fourth Circuit realized that that's not so easy to apply in the modern workplace, and so the critical inquiry is really who's running or managing a business versus involved in just the daily carrying out of the business functions. So what the Fourth Circuit is looking at is how high level are you? And here they said the investigators had no supervisory authority, they couldn't implement or recommend changes in policies or strategy, and therefore they couldn't establish that their functions were really directly related to the management of the business. The other thing that the Fourth Circuit notably rejected was the fact that these investigators support claims adjusters who all parties agreed are generally exempt under the administrative exemption. That didn't provide any help. Just because you support administratively exempt employees does not make you yourself administratively exempt. But they did acknowledge that the issue presents a very close legal question. So now rewind back 2 years, because the Fourth Circuit was not writing on a blank slate. Foster versus Nationwide was a nearly identical case that arose in the Sixth Circuit. Again, investigators, this time for Nationwide, claimed that they were misclassified. The primary duty was to conduct investigations into suspicious claims with the purpose or goal of resolving indicators of fraud. And the trial court in Foster ruled pretty much identically to what the trial court had done in Calderon. That is, they may have satisfied the directly related to the management prong, but they did not satisfy the sufficient discretion and independent judgment prong. Goes up to the Sixth Circuit, and the Sixth Circuit disagreed. The Sixth Circuit disagreed with the trial court, but they also disagreed with the Fourth Circuit. They said these employees are administratively exempt. They said Nationwide did establish by preponderance of the evidence. So in the Sixth Circuit, employers don't have to satisfy the criteria by clear and convincing, just by the more standard preponderance of the evidence, that the investigator's primary duty was directly related to the management of the enterprise. They also said this administrative and production dichotomy is useful. They gave it more credence than the Fourth Circuit did, and said the fact that they are supporting claims adjusters who are acknowledged to be exempt does help the claim. And so they say that the investigators and the adjusters both exempt under this prong. Now, the main difference, I think, when you drill down to what the difference was between these two cases, is that the Sixth Circuit isn't requiring that employees perform as high-level functions. Lower-level, mid-level managers likely would satisfy this prong, at least under the Sixth Circuit's test. And then the Sixth Circuit went on to reach the question that the Fourth Circuit didn't need to, and that is, did the investigator's primary duty involve sufficient discretion and judgment? They say yes, because their whole function was to really make an ultimate determination as to whether fraud was taking place. So again, as you can see, the duties test can be very difficult to apply. Courts often don't agree. The Department of Labor often doesn't agree with courts. And so the Department of Labor used this, pointing to examples, not necessarily these cases, but other cases like it, as reasons why they wanted and needed to raise the salary threshold. Because what they wanted to do is reduce reliance on the duties test and ensure that the salary test was set high enough so that it is likely to actually serve as a appropriate demarcation of those who are performing higher level administrative and exempt functions and those who are not. And one of the examples they pointed to is actually interesting. It was a case that the Department of Labor themselves had brought back in the early 1980s. It was a case involving Burger King and their assistant managers, and the Department of Labor had claimed that they were misclassified. The First Circuit and the Second Circuit both addressed the issue, and they both concluded that at that time when the long duties and short duties tests that Tom had referenced earlier were in effect, the courts had concluded that those who had to meet the more stringent long duties test because they were paid less, they were found not to be exempt under the long duties test, but those who had to meet only the minimal short duties test were found to be exempt, even though all the employees, regardless of what they were paid, performed the same exact functions. And so the Department of Labor said we need to use the salary threshold as a way to kind of properly demarcate exempt versus non-exempt employees, so we're not just relying on the duty test.
Okay. So fast forward, you've now gone through the 500-odd pages of the new regulation. You've sifted through it and parsed finally the DOL's guidance, and you know everything there is to know about the salary level test and how it can be applied. So are you out of the woods? Well, unfortunately not, because as is often the case, we can't forget about state law. Many states have minimum wage and overtime laws that differ either significantly or in minor aspects from the Fair Labor Standards Act. And if a state's exemption requirements are more favorable to employees, meaning that that employees may be entitled to overtime under state law even if they're not under the FLSA, that state law will apply. Now, we've indicated here that California is a significant example. I would imagine it's not a surprise to very many of you that California is kind of on the vanguard in terms of extending protections to employees. But California is certainly not the only example. For those of you who may be in Pennsylvania, there are significant differences between Pennsylvania law and the Fair Labor Standards Act. One notable example is that while there is a specific exemption under the FLSA for computer employees or certain classes of computer employees, there is no similar exemption under Pennsylvania law. But let's use California here as an example to show how there can be significant differences. Under California law, there are different salary level tests and duties tests. California's Industrial Welfare Commission issues wage orders addressing the exemption status of certain classes of employees, and there are 17 such orders that have currently been issued. California Labor Code Section 515, which was enacted in 2001 in response to a number of administrative and judicial developments, states that an employee may be exempt, subject to the wage orders, if he or she is primarily engaged in duties that meet the test of the exemption, if he or she customarily and regularly exercises discretion and independent judgment, and if he or she earns a monthly salary equivalent to no less than two times the state minimum wage for full-time employment. Now, skipping ahead on the slide here, that third salary level test that California has is extremely significant. Prior to the current revisions in the FLSA regulations, California law, which has recently raised its minimum wage to $10 an hour, had a salary level that was about $42,000, or that's where it is now. Now the FLSA has leapfrogged that, but that is not likely to be the case for much longer. As you may have heard, California recently enacted legislation pursuant to which it will be raising its hourly wage to $15 per hour by 2022. And this is going to be implemented in steps over the next 6 years. So shortly, the salary level under the California law is going to again outpace the federal requirement. So employers in California are going to need to be attuned to this. It's yet another nuance in California that employers must deal with. As mentioned, and coming back to the discussion of the duties test that we've been talking about, California also has a distinct duties test. Specifically, as Tom alluded to, the statute defines primarily engaged to mean that the employee spends more than one half of his or her time on exempt duties. So whereas there is no quantitative threshold under the Fair Labor Standards Act, there is an express threshold under California law. Additionally, the California duties test incorporates what are sometimes referred to as quantitative and qualitative components. Jeff spoke before about how under the Fair Labor Standards Act, at least under the Calderon decision, that it's really the character of the employee's work and not whether or not that work is important or critical to employer's operations that matter. Well, in California, both of those things matter. Under the qualitative component, an employee must be engaged in duties that require the exercise of discretion and independent judgment. But in additionally, the so-called quantitative component requires that the duties be of substantial importance to the employer's business. So we're going to highlight briefly just one case, a relatively recent case that puts in stark relief how California law can lead to different results than the Fair Labor Standards Act. Reeve versus Coventry Healthcare, a federal decision, dealt with the classification of case managers who were overseeing workers' compensation cases. These case managers were required to be licensed registered nurses, but they did not directly provide care. They were agreed that they provided case management services, such as documenting costs of care, preparing reports, and identifying and implementing medical services. However, the case managers had no authority to order treatment or to modify treatment plans, which were dictated exclusively by physicians. If looking at this case under both the FLSA and the California Labor Code, the court concluded that the employees were properly classified as exempt under the FLSA but were non-exempt under the California Labor Code. This involved the application of two of the exemptions, the professional exemption as well as the administrative exemption. Under the Fair Labor Standards Act, pursuant to governing regulations, RNs who are engaged in the practice of nursing are considered exempt financial professional employees. The court in Reeve looked at this and concluded that although the plaintiffs were not necessarily engaged in the practice of nursing, they were nevertheless closely aligned with RNs who practice nursing. Therefore, the court concluded that they fell within the professional exemption under the FLSA. Turning to the California law, which specifically treats nurses differently under the professional exemption. They noted that RNs who practice nursing are not exempt professional employees in California. They then looked at the question of whether they could be exempt administrative employees. Looking at the quantitative component of the test that we talked about previously, the court found that the work was not of substantial importance to the management or operations of the business, and therefore the employees were not exempt under California law. So this is just one example that highlights how important it is to understand the specifics of the jurisdiction in which you're operating and make sure that while the FLSA establishes a baseline, it's not the only thing you need to be concerned about.
And it also just highlights the fact that, again, it's usually the duties test that is the most difficult to apply and that can spawn litigation. And so employers will be happy to hear that the Department of Labor has predicted that this new rule will actually reduce litigation, because they are assuming that employers, in order to comply with the new rule, are going to not necessarily change the compensation of employees to meet the new salary minimum, but rather they're just going to reclassify them as non-exempt, essentially taking the duties test, which can be difficult to apply, out of the equation. And so here I kind of set forth one of the passages from the 500-plus page rule that kind of explains this analysis, and basically reiterating that we think, or the Department of Labor thinks, that this is actually going to reduce litigation. And after they did a whole bunch of calculations, they actually wound up concluding that precisely it is going to be 4.3% of FLSA cases are going to be avoidable, because those are the number of cases where it's going to involve employees between this current salary level of $455 per week and the new level of $913, which may not seem like a lot percentage-wise, but as far as sheer numbers, it is actually a fair amount. The Department of Labor noted that the number of Fair Labor Standards Act cases that have been filed over the past 15 years or so has just skyrocketed. In 2001, there were about 2,000 FLSA cases filed per year. By 2012, and even as recently as 2014, it was more than 8,000 cases per year that were filed under the FLSA. So it is actually a fair number. So what next? Well, December 1st, 2016, if you haven't heard that date enough, saying it again, mark it on your calendars. It is the date that you must be in compliance with this new rule. The Department of Labor got a lot of comments where they were asked to give some sort of grace period to comply, or they were asked to give a lot more time than what they ultimately wound up giving to comply, citing the burden it's going to put on employers. The Department of Labor ultimately concluded that they would give more time than they generally do. They generally give 3 or 4 months. Here they're giving 5.5 to 6 months notice. And so they said that's more than enough time to come into compliance, so there's no safe harbor that's needed. And by the way, don't worry, the Wage and Hour Division is going to issue guidance documents to help employers and employees comply with the new rule. Many of those guidance documents are actually already out. If you go onto the Wage and Hour Division's website, you will see that many of them are there already. But as far as what you should do probably most immediately, the first thing you probably want to do is conduct a wage and hour compliance audit. Now, that's a broad term. It can take a lot of different forms, but Tom is now going to explain some of the key elements that will help you to come into compliance with the new rule.
I think that for all employers, one of the messages that the DOL is really clearly sending, particularly with this idea of automatic indexing, is that you're going to need to review the classification of your workers at least every 3 years to make sure that you're in compliance. And as Ian talked about in terms of counting the bonuses, you really may need to review them quarterly, particularly if you're depending upon those commissions or non-discretionary bonuses in terms of counting them. I'll also say that I think that the rule provides an opportunity for employers who have issues related to particular groups of employees that may have questionable classification to reclassify them as part of the overall effort to review classifications as a result of this particular rule. What should you do first if you're going to do a wage and hour audit? Well, the first thing is you really need to focus on the employees who are earning less than $47,476, that minimum standard, that threshold. Those folks are now below the bright line, and you're going to have to decide what it is you're going to do with them. Now, consider how it is they actually are above or below the threshold there with the $47,476. Are you considering non-discretionary bonuses and commissions when determining the cutoff? You know, as Ian mentioned, I think that you're going to have to review your bonus and commission plans if you plan to try to take advantage of counting the bonus or commissions towards the threshold. Most employers that we deal with, at least, are interested in preserving some amount of discretion, usually in reference to the state law of their particular jurisdiction, related to, for instance, the Pennsylvania Wage Payment Collection Law or others that define when a wage is actually payable and earned. Most try to build discretion into those plans. You need to be careful that if you're going to try to count the bonuses and commissions towards the $47,476, that they are non-discretionary, and you should be careful that the company is not taking inconsistent positions in different matters related to whether or not something is discretionary or not. The other thing I would point out is, again, this quarterly requirement that Ian spoke about is significant. Most employers, with the exception of sales commissions, which I think often are actually paid quarterly, end-of-year profitability bonuses are just that, end-of-year profitability bonuses, and are not paid out on a quarterly basis. And I think most employers are not going to want to alter that system because how do you determine your profitability partway through the fiscal year? Most people would be unwilling to do that and to issue bonuses based on sort of a mid-year figure. The third thing you need to understand as part of the wage and hour audit is how much are people really working? According to the DOL, they believe that 60% of the people who will be reclassified as non-exempt or overtime eligible, in fact, actually don't really work overtime. So so that there should be no net effect to the employer in terms of cost. Whether or not that's true or not, I don't know. Most of the folks that we work with don't really track the hours that are worked by, quote, you know, exempt employees. It would sort of defeat the purpose, and most people actually think that making them record those hours might be an indicator that they are really, in fact, non-exempt and not exempt. The fourth thing you want to do here is you want to review the current handling of overtime. How are you doing this? How are managers actually functioning? How are they approving it? Because they're now going to have to bear more of the burden depending on how you respond to these newly overtime eligible employees. What do you do for those above the threshold? Well, for those above the threshold that you may review again as part of this process, and again, you may want to look at some of the categories of employees where they might be in the gray area, particularly for the administrative exemption. You're going to want to look at those. What do you do? Well, the first thing I would tell you is this takes more time than you think because you've got to gather information from a number of sources. And what I would say is people are often surprised by what they find. The first is to review a job description. Well, you know, the DOL has been clear, wage and hour division has been clear, the law is clear. Job descriptions don't determine people's classifications, but they are part of what is considered. So look at the job descriptions that you have in place. Look at the ones that are really being used. The second is look at performance evaluations. You can often tell what people are doing in terms of exempt or non-exempt activities based upon looking at what key projects are, what they've done in terms of supervisory responsibilities, and things like that. It also gives you a sense, I think, in many cases, of how it is the employee's job responsibilities have evolved over time. The gold standard is really to interview the employee and the manager or some selection of employees so you get a sense of what people in the class are actually doing. And then lastly, for folks above the threshold, you again want to compare the duties test and the prior rulings and guidance that have been issued for that particular job. Inevitably, you are not unique. Most folks don't have unique titles. There's been some case or guidance that's actually been issued. What do you do with the newly overtime eligible? This is really the problem that faces everybody right now. You only have a number of limited options here. The first is to increase the salary level to the new threshold and continue to classify the employee as exempt. Now, many people are not going to do this because they think that it actually will result in increased cost for them, which of course it will. The one thing I want you to think about, if you're considering this particular option, is the ripple effect. So we can see cases where, for instance, on the West Coast, there was an employer within the last year or so who decided to raise employees who were below something like $50,000 or $70,000 up to that level because he thought that that was a living wage. The problem is they didn't increase all of the people who already earned above that number, and the people who earned above the number were very, very unhappy that now the difference between them and the other folks had been diminished, and they felt as if their contributions to the company were not being appropriately valued. Think about that ripple effect that's out there. You also need to keep in mind if you're going to raise people, you want to keep raising them so that you keep ahead of that automatic indexing that's going to be in place, so that you never have a problem with that. What's the next option? We'll reclassify the employees to non-exempt status and pay them overtime. Treat them as non-exempt or overtime eligible. What's the first way to do it? Well, you can convert them to hourly or to salaried non-exempts. There's a myth out there that says if you pay someone a salary, they're always exempt. That's not true. The DOL even comments on that in the rule, in the commentary. They believe that most folks will convert to leave them at salaried non-exempt. I don't think that's actually true. I think most folks are actually converting to hourly. That's what we're certainly hearing from people. Note that when you convert people to hourly from salaried exempt, sometimes you have issues in terms of morale. People view that as a lower status position. Even if the amount of money that they earn is exactly the same. The DOL views it as the flip side. People, they think, will be happy about that because they will, in fact, actually earn more. They may actually have more free time on the outside. I don't know. We'll see how it works out. You'll need to decide on an hourly rate of pay in connection with the conversion if that's how you go. You can set the hourly rate lower to take into account anticipated overtime earnings, but it's, again, hard to anticipate those earnings if you haven't already tracked the time that these exempt employees are working now. And the other thing is we see there's a question as to whether or not people will set that wage lower. So if you multiplied it times 40 and then times 52, would they come out at a lower salary than the people are earning now? The DOL says no because they believe that wages are sticky and the labor market won't respond to that positively. But I think the real answer is who knows. I think that certainly there's some indication in the comments that they received that already that is what is happening at many employers. Finally, you know, you're going to want to look at limiting and prohibiting overtime work. You're going to want to make sure that your policy is clear on that point. And you're going to want to make sure that you understand what counts as work. I think the fight here is going to move from the duties test to what counts as compensable time. That's what we're going to see with this movement. I don't think the duties test litigation, by the way, is going to go away. I think it's just that now we're going to get a lot more questions about what time counts as compensable. What should you do in terms of implementing your wage and hour audit findings and after you've decided how to proceed? And I guess I should just back up for 1 second here and talk about what I would describe as the problem group, which are job categories where you have folks that will fall above and below the threshold, and what do you do with them? You can raise them all up in terms of salary, but that isn't really feasible for many folks. We think that the way most people are now responding is to turn everybody in that category into a non-exempt employee and to usually pay them on an hourly basis. I think it is very difficult to have a class where you split between non-exempt and exempt based simply on the threshold. And you're going to have, if you do that, be prepared for the fact that the folks who are categorized as non-exempt may complain, and you may face difficulty explaining to them why they are categorized one way and why the others are categorized as, in fact, actually non-exempt.
A couple of notes here on implementation, and one of the things to note if you do run into this split classification, you may have employees who are classified as exempt who may be unhappy that they're not eligible for overtime, even though some of their coworkers are. A couple of notes here. With respect to your time recording systems, the new regulations may present some challenges. One of the most significant ones may be if you do elect to take into account bonuses, commissions, incentive payments as part of your compensation. Many employer systems are not set up to handle that. And how are you going to make sure that you hit that threshold with the bonuses and that you provide yourself with the opportunity to make any catch-up payments that may be required on a quarterly basis? Review and update your policies. This is, as Tom pointed out, one of the next likely issues is going to be compensable time. When you have employees who were previously exempt, maybe performing managerial roles who you're now going to be treating as non-exempt, what time, what efforts on their behalf, what do you need to take into account in terms of emails and texts that they may send, work from home? That time can be compensable, and if you're treating employees as non-exempt, you're going to have to come up with ways to make sure that you capture that time. How do you deliver the news? Tom and Jeff have highlighted some of the employee morale issues that you need to deal with. What do you do? The DOL has suggested that you simply tell employees that, well, there's been a change in the law, so we have to change your status. And that may be a sort of high-level message, but there are nuances that you'll need to be attuned to with respect to particular classifications. Certainly, if you're going to be reducing somebody's hourly wage in order to normalize their overall compensation by taking into account employment overtime, you're going to have to be ready to deal with that employee who now thinks that they've gotten a cut in their wages. And finally, distribute, review, and train your employees about your policies and the time recording mechanics. Your policies are only as good as their implementation, so make sure that employees and managers alike know what the requirements are and how you're going to be dealing with those things. Now I think we're going to take a few minutes to talk about some of the poll results and maybe some questions that have come in.
Right. So I think that we will start with one question as the poll tally is coming in. And the first question we have is, if we reclassify some employees as salaried non-exempt, are there any requirements to punch in out for the day, or can they simply provide us, the employer, a weekly listing of hours worked? Well, some of that depends, I guess, on where you are. So if you're in California, you're going to want to track the number of hours they're working every day. The basic obligation is that you have to understand the hours and be able to prove the hours that they are working. The burden is on the employer to keep that record. I think that it is probably better to treat everybody the same. So if you already have folks that are recording time in a time system through ADP or one of the others, I think it's best to have them actually do it on a daily basis. It also will give you better reporting than you would on a weekly basis in case you're seeing spikes in overtime in a particular department. But to answer the basic question, no, you don't specifically have to require someone to punch in and punch out, but you do have to record the time accurately. Weekly would be acceptable in some jurisdictions, but I think you're better off treating everybody the same.
And in that case, you also need to make sure, this is another area where you need to make sure you're aware of the wage laws in each of the states, because some of the states do impose requirements on what information you have to capture for non-exempt employees, and so you may need to adjust your timekeeping system to make sure that you are complying with those policies.
Yeah, I mean, certainly with the timekeeping system, you're going to want to train people very well with how to use it. What we've run into is folks who previously were treated as exempt, who are being converted into non-exempt, often don't understand actually the timekeeping system. That said, I have actually seen a number of organizations where those folks already have some time recording obligations related to particular projects that they track. So it may not be so unfamiliar, at least for some folks. We have another question. Can you please give an example of how bonuses are allowed to be calculated? Ian, do you want to handle that one?
Sure. As we talked about, the bonuses can be calculated by whatever non-discretionary formula you establish. Employees are entitled to payment of that bonus on a quarterly basis. It can be based on achievement, as Tom mentioned previously, company profitability. It can be based on sales in connection with commission employees. The critical factor is that it be non-discretionary, that the employee know in advance what criteria are going to be used. And obviously, the employee needs to actually receive those. So if an employee fails to meet whatever criteria you've established and thereby, as a result of not receiving that bonus, is below the salary threshold for a particular quarter, you have the alternative of making a catch-up payment as described, or you would need to treat that person as non-exempt for that particular period, which obviously creates its own headaches as far as implementation.
We have another question. Any clear guidance on paralegals or compliance professionals under the EAP requirements? The answer there is no. We've seen them, in fact, actually treated both ways, but I would say the bulk of them, in fact, actually are treated as non-exempt in our experience, with the exception being those who are exempt.
Yeah, the problem usually comes in, they try to get them under the administrative exemption, and the Department of Labor often takes the view that they don't satisfy the independent discretion and judgment prong, because it's really the attorneys who have the discretion and judgment and not the paralegal. So it is much more common to see them as non-exempt.
No, I see we're at 1 o'clock. We'll continue to answer the questions that have come in and to go over the poll for those of you who still want to join us. We're not going to just shut it off at 1. We have another question. If you avail yourself of the new law and reclassify to non-exempt, will the company have to go back and pay overtime for the last 2 years that employees were misclassified? Well, the answer is, if you're relying simply on the threshold to reclassify, the answer is no. You aren't going to have to go back. If you're doing something else to correct a misclassification that existed regardless of the threshold, then you may have some issue. And one of the things that employers are facing is, how do you deliver this news so you don't trigger claims? What I would say is, so many people are reclassifying that I think it's going to be hard, for instance, for folks to think that there's something suspicious going on. I know in cases where I've been involved and we've reclassified within the last year as a result of the regulations and what we thought they were going to be, you know, most people actually are familiar with this. It's been covered in the news frequently enough that I think that actually it's actually okay. So we have another question. What is to stop an employer paying over $50,000 to a manager from simply increasing that employee's minimum hours? Well, nothing. In fact, is actually the answer there. You can certainly, you know, ask them to work as many hours as you like, so long as it's legal. If they're exempt, there's no hourly requirement that's strictly speaking in place.
Yeah, the key is just to make sure that they are actually properly classified as exempt
right.
under the duties test. If they're not, then you can certainly ask them to work the hours, but you're going to have to pay them for overtime.
All right. We have another question. Does the new threshold apply to part-time exempt employees, or can you prorate it based on their part-time exempt hours? We actually had a slide in there about this. We took it out because we were worried we had so much material to cover. I think that was Ian's slide. I'll let Ian tell you about it.
That's right. The Department of Labor declined to specifically put in a rule for this, essentially saying our general rule applies. If employees are is a part-time employee who works fewer than 40 hours a week, they will be, as long as they're paid the minimum wage, they have no entitlement to additional overtime. If, however, a part-time employee who's paid less than the overall the general salary threshold happens to go beyond 40 hours per week, well, in that case, they're going to be entitled to compensation, overtime compensation for that time. So the answer is part-time employees are treated just like other employees for purposes of this regulation.
We have a question. Can you have some employees who meet the minimum dollar threshold as exempt and some as hourly who do not meet the dollar limit? The answer is yes, that's that mixed class that we talked about, and what do you do with them? I think that really does provide a challenge for most employers. We have a question as to whether or not there are special accommodations that are made for nonprofits in the rules, and the answer is no. In fact, there's a large section actually in the final rule about comments that they receive from nonprofits around the country, asking for a special safe harbor, delayed implementation, exemption, and the answer was no, no, and no. That in fact they're subject to the same rule as everyone else, at least for this purpose. You know, handling nonprofits and the application of the FLSA is always a little tricky, but generally you tell people to assume that they in fact are actually covered by the FLSA. I will point out that they rejected what I would see is at least a somewhat compelling argument from small nonprofits, in particular, I believe Habitat for Humanity submitted comment and said that most of their folks earn less than $50,000 a year. And therefore, most of their employees, if not all of their employees, are going to be categorized as non-exempt, as overtime eligible, even though they would satisfy the duties test in many cases. And the DOL said, yes, so they don't particularly care. There were arguments that were made that this was going to take resources away from these small nonprofits, and again, the DOL was not sympathetic at all in terms of how it was addressing them.
The DOL has actually issued guidance specifically geared towards nonprofits and how the new rule relates, and that you can, if you're interested in that, it's on the Wage and Hour Division's website.
There, in fact, actually is plenty of guidance for nonprofits. It's an issue that comes up quite frequently with schools as well as other kinds of nonprofits. Now the polling. Have you read the final FLSA white-collar exemptions? Well, 45% of you are certainly dedicated readers for going through all 500 pages. No, say 55%. Have you reviewed the classification of any of your employees as exempt or non-exempt within the last 12 months? Good for the 69% of you who say yes, you've done that. Those of you who said no, you have some work to do by December the 1st to make sure you're compliant. Will the new rule result in your company reclassifying any of your employees as non-exempt? 68% of you said yes. 28% of you said no. I think for those of you who say no, that's a surprising answer to me. I would think that at least in some places, most places, that they would be reclassifying some employees. But there have been some very large employers recently who said it's going to have very little effect on them, because I think they already treat many of the folks who are below this threshold as overtime eligible. If so, if you're going to reclassify people, what percentage of your employees will be reclassified as a result of the new rule? Well, 64% of you said 10% or less. 16% of you said 25%, 10 to 25%. So that's about what we would expect in most workplaces. I think if you're in retail or in food service, we expect that to be higher, and certainly the DOL does, because their minimum threshold here is now set above the average wage according to the census for both the food service industry as well as retail. Do you track the amount of time that currently exempt employees spend working? And the answer is no, say 85% of you. That doesn't surprise me at all. I think that's the way it usually works. And I think it makes it hard to estimate the impact of choosing to, you know, increase people's salaries or to make them overtime eligible and turn them into hourlies. How do you plan to respond to the new rule with regard to the newly overtime eligible employees? Well, interestingly, more than half of you say that you're going to convert employees from salary-based to hourly pay. That certainly isn't what the DOL hopes happens. They would prefer for you to stick at salaried, non-exempt, because I think they think it's actually better for the employees for a number of reasons. But as I said, I think that most of the folks that we're running into are really converting to hourly. In second place, this is interesting. Basically, a quarter of you said that you would also increase the salary of employees, and I wonder how close those folks are to the threshold. Certainly, if you're within 5%, 10%, I think many people are going to consider it. But if you're doing that, remember that ripple effect and how it may undermine morale or create other issues for you.
And also, just to note, certainly keep an eye on and be ready to see how that changes when the first set of automatic indexing increases come in, because you know, we have yet to see how the taking some of those non-exempt employees out of the pool that's contributing to the number, how that's going to impact the final numbers. So you need to be looking down the road, recognizing that it's not going to be a one-time change.
Yeah, remember in 2020 when the first reset takes place, assuming no challenge that's successful, that the DOL currently anticipates it, you know, rising to about $50,000 a year, $51,000 a year. But if you start removing large numbers of people and converting them to hourly, you may get a spike that's actually greater than that, and so your threshold may suddenly, you know, get away from you. Do you currently allow non-exempt employees to work from home? 64% of you say no, 36% of you say yes. It's interesting. I think, again, as the debate shifts for these folks who are below the threshold, it's going to be all about what time is compensable, and there's no more active part of the litigation in that area except those related to emailing, texting, responding to sort of after-hours calls. We also get issues about travel time and things like that, but the texting, emailing, that stuff is it really is fodder for litigation, and I think we're going to see more of it as this threshold rises. What do you predict the overall effect of the new role will be on your business? Well, we had a whopping 0% of you say that it would be positive.
Not surprising.
Not surprising. I think a lot of people actually think it will have a positive effect on employees, certainly.
Yeah.
And even many employers believe that it was overdue, the increase in the exemption threshold, as a matter of fairness. But they disagree with how high it actually has gotten, that they wanted it to be lower, or they wanted it to be phased in over time. I think SHRM actually wanted to be phased in over a year or something like that, and the DOL said no, of course. Most of you actually said things will stay just about the same, and I think that's what most people think. I think if you actually get ahead of it and you manage it, you think about the issues before December the 1st, I think you will be able to make sure that at least economically you turn out in roughly the same spot, but it's going to require a lot of vigilance. Well, that's all the time we have for questions in the polling today. Thank you for joining us. I will point out that we have some upcoming programs. If you haven't registered for it, certainly go to our website and look. We have a seminar in our London office by members of our labor and employment group over there about employment and data privacy and cybersecurity teams, always a challenge, and particularly so if you have employees in Europe. And finally, we have a seminar that's coming up in New York on June the 21st related to gender equality and the new laws that were recently passed in New York. They became effective earlier this year, getting a lot of attention. Thank you again for joining us.